Jr., my son, pulled the cord to do the unveiling. Now, he was just a young man, and I know I was raising him to be like his father, and perhaps that was such a strong image that I now think back on it, and perhaps it was not the thing to do. But he was magnificent that day. And whenever we can, we bring groups out here so that they may not only learn about the Haymarket, but feel about it the way that we do, and to encourage you to be more active, not only in your unions, but your workplace and with your fellow men. And the rights that Albert and I and his comrades felt so strongly about was also freedom of speech. And as you know, even now, freedom of speech is not exactly what it should be, but we have to keep fighting for it. Now, when I come out to talk to Albert, I usually tell him about all my activities, where I've been traveling and what I've done. And today I wanted to tell him about my trip to London. And when I was invited there to speak, this was after the executions. So I sailed from New York to London. And I told the group, what a pleasure it is to be here on the anniversary of the Haymarket. It's so gratifying to know that not only Oscar Wilde, but other comrades have spoken out and support the Haymarket 8. It warms my heart and makes me feel that our support is steady growing. Well, I have been treated with the greatest indignities in the prisons in America, but I don't complain because it was for the cause. Let nobody say, I've done this, or I did this, or I suffered that. It was for the cause, and the cause is above you and me. It's the very breath of life. It's that freedom that we feel. So it's wherever there's a man or woman beneath the sun who wants a better home, better life, better food, better clothes. I hear that all over when I'm traveling. In Italy, in the sunny climes across the mighty Atlantic seas. I hear it in the prisons in Joliet, in the state of Illinois. There are people who are so destitute and so broken. And with this company, this country that's rich with happiness and jewels and worthy things, that no man or woman beneath the sun should have to suffer. Then everybody, whether it's the little man on the totem pole or the one up there that we have to fight so hard. Wherever there is a man or woman beneath the sun, they should have all the rights that have been given to them. So thank you for coming. And if you want to talk more, Stephanie will certainly lead you in her spiel about the things that she's planning on doing. But I find that after the execution of Albert, it was very difficult for us, for me and the children. And I was the sole survivor, the sole benefit to keep us, our family alive, to keep us eating. And a word had come down in the city of Chicago that I was not to speak. And I went to a rally, one of the rallies I went to, and I was talking and I spoke out, and the man said, if you don't shut up, I'll knock your teeth down your throat. Well, the group that was there, they protested and were very supportive of me at that time. But that went on for years and years, but that didn't stop me. That didn't stop me at all, because Albert and I had suffered so many other things that were more difficult than that. And I continue to talk out wherever I can, because these are men. What man or woman do you know has died for labor? Albert and his comrades died for labor. And we must never forget, never. Thank you.
Thank you so much. things I'd love to do is get a picture with all of you with Ms. Parsons, but first we have an announcement from these two wonderful ladies.
If you would like to hear more from Lucy Parsons and learn more about her life and Albert's life and what went on in the Haymarket affair, why we celebrate May Day on May 1st, come to my workshop on Sunday morning. It's called International Workers' Day, the History and Contemporary Context of the Haymarket Affair. Lucy will be one of the speakers.
Yay!
So what we're going to do is I would like to also invite Mr. Mark Rogovin to say just a brief word. Mark is the author of the book that you all should have gotten, and there's a much more updated version that he also has. So he'll say a brief word. So what we're going to do is he'll say a brief word, we'll take a group picture, then I encourage you to walk around. Lucy Parsons' grave is here to the right.
By the red rose.
Behind here is the plaque that Governor Alkeld, that we were talking about on our bus when he pardoned the martyrs, what he said. And then we're going to gather just a little bit more down where that grave is, the chest piece right there, that is Emma Goldman's grave. And we're going to talk a little bit about some of the graves over there really briefly. So first we'll take a picture, and then if you have any questions for Mark and Lucy, and then we'll go over there.
There's only one way we would do that. If you would give us like $125,000.
Just gather around. We have a couple of presenters.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Then you all know that I am Lucy Parsons. I was married to Albert Parsons, and he is underneath this monument.
This is the truth.
This is the truth. His name is on the back over there if you'd like to take a look. We met on my uncle's farm when I lived in Waco, Texas, and he was traveling on horseback registering people to vote. Well, he kept finding excuses to come by our farm, you know, and then anything. So I said, "You're here quite often." He said, "Well, it's just an excuse to see you, Lucy." No, well, I was very flattered. But in that climate, though, it was not too conducive to an interracial couple. So when things got a little testy, we decided to move to Chicago. And when you got to Chicago, Albert saw what the situation was like. You know, there were no jobs, and the people were working the long hours in the factories. And he started to speak out against all the all the wrongs that were happening in the city. And then he joined one of the unions in which he could speak out more freely. So that's how we started to form the group about the 8-hour workday. Now some of this I will talk about on Sunday, but that's how it all started. And so after the execution, after the trial, that was terrible, and after the executions, I decided to do traveling. I traveled all over, everywhere. I traveled by whatever was available, you know, the bus or the train, even the planes, because contributions were made in their honor. But my first traveling bit was to raise money for their trials, okay? And I went to all the different cities. And we had hopes that maybe the Supreme Court would hear us, but they wouldn't. They turned us down. And Albert decided that, all right, this is how it's going to be. If I have to give my life, I will give it for this cause. I was devastated after that. And it was very difficult for me and my family. But when I come out and I talk to him about it, I feel so much better. I just feel that he is listening, and this is what we used to do.
He was a great speaker. So he always wanted to know what I was going to talk about, what I was going to say. So today I told him about the speech that I gave in London. So I said, what a pleasure it is to be here in your city. It's very gratifying to know that not only the literary people of this city support us, but your Socialist League. It warms my heart and lets me know that our support is steady growing. Well, I have been treated with the greatest indignities in the prisons in America, but I don't complain because I have thrown myself in the path of established order, and we who do that must expect to take the consequences. But it was for the cause, and the cause is above you and me. It's the very breath of life. Let nobody say that I have done this or I have suffered this. The cause, it's always for the cause. I see it in the people across the Atlantic, in Italy. I see it in the prisons with the men in Joliet. Wherever there's a man, a woman beneath the sun who wants a better home, better food, better clothes, the world, with all its riches and its happiness and its treasures, should, like the air and the sunshine, belong to all mankind and not just the few. Thank you.
Amen.
I have a feeling that he was pleased. He was a great speaker. But life without him is still difficult. But we have our memories, and whenever I can tell the story, I do. Because it's the retelling that keeps their memory alive. And we must never, never forget. So it's so good to see you here. He believes strongly in unions and trade unions. And then the conditions that were so terrible in the sweatshops and the factories, he always spoke out about that. That was one of our main things about the 8-hour workday. We wanted the conditions to change. And even though it didn't happen right then, it was years later, but I do believe that because of what he did and his comrades, that what we have today, that people sometimes don't appreciate, that they have the breaks, they have the 8 hours. Some people are working 2 or 3 jobs, but it's how you're treated on those jobs that goes all the way back to when Albert and his comrades died for labor. I asked the group earlier, do you know anyone who has died for labor?
Yeah,
I know. Male or female? But they did. They so strongly believed. And that belief, I hope is contagious. And it should be. So if things aren't going well in your workplace, speak up. Let people know, you know? I mean, not to the point that you probably lose your job, because unless you have another one in mind. I strongly believe that you have to have another job if you fix to quit that one. But don't let them treat you as though you're not human. Those rights are sacred. And it's so good to see all of you. Oh, and especially so many women. I love it. I love it. So please come again.
Thank you.
If any of you were inspired by what Lucy had to say today and you'd like to learn more and hear more from her, please come to our workshop on Sunday morning. It's called International Workers' Day, the History and Contemporary Context of the Haymarket Affair. Lucy will be a speaker at that panel, and we would love to have you.
Thank you.
And I just want to make a quick announcement. If you're on buses 1 or 2, you're about to leave. So. If you're on buses 1 or 2, get on the bus.
The shop.
would you mind taking a picture?
Right, you got to get in line.
Yes. Group picture. Let's take a group picture.
Right.
Oh, yeah. You want a group picture?
Well, right now I'm just going to take the one.
Oh, okay. She wants one person.
Thank you. 1, 2. Thank you.
Okay, perfect. Good.
Appreciate your effort.
Can we go back?
Sure. With me?